Simon & Schuster Audio presents Star Trek Voyager, Architects of Infinity by Kirsten Beyer. Based on Star Trek, created by Gene Roddenberry, and Star Trek Voyager, created by Rick Berman, Michael Piller, and Jerry Taylor. Read by January LaVoy. For Margaret. Historian's Note. Admiral Kathryn Janeway leads the Full Circle Fleet, Voyager, Vesta, Galen, and Demeter, on a mission of exploration in the Delta Quadrant. Many things have changed since a lone, lost starship Voyager was trying to find her way home. The fleet is charged with discovering what has changed since Voyager was last here and the ultimate power in the quadrant, the Borg, departed. This story takes place in August 2382 CE. All things done before the naked stars are remembered. John M. Ford. Prologue. USS Vesta.
Well?
Admiral Kathryn Janeway asked as she stared into the placid, orange and golden eyes of the Department of Temporal Investigation's current director, Lauren Andos. Despite the disconcerting report Janeway had just given the director regarding her fleet's recent encounter with the Krenim, the Rilnar, and the Zal, and the multiple violations of the Temporal Prime Directive that had occurred during their mission to retrieve a temporally displaced version of Kathryn Janeway, Andos remained completely composed. She was a Rondorite and, rumor had it, over 200 years old. Janeway was well aware that during her service to the Federation, Andos had seen or studied a number of incredibly complicated temporal disturbances. If the equanimity with which she seemed to accept the Admiral's report was any indication, there must be little by now that could faze the woman.
Are you still in possession of the temporal synchronization disruptors this Agent Dane distributed among your crew members during the first temporal incursion in which you knowingly participated?
Andos asked evenly.
We are, Janeway replied. They don't work anymore.
You attempted to use them again?
Andos asked, her voice rising a fraction of a hair.
Of course not, Director. By the time we returned to Vesta and removed them, they were dead. Our scanners won't detect their presence, and we didn't think it was a good idea to take one apart and go digging around for its power source. We simply cataloged them and stored them in our new temporally shielded hold.
I thought you said you had integrated temporal shielding into all of your fleet vessels once you realized the threat posed by the Krenim and their ability to manipulate the timeline.
We did. The temporal shields draw a great deal of power from our other systems. It's not practical to operate them around the clock. No pun intended.
I see.
We have isolated a few crucial artifacts as well as copies of all of our logs. Those are always shielded. We are looking for ways to expand this defensive capability without disrupting other vital operations. It's likely that within the next few months we will have found another solution. My hope is that you will be able to assess the ongoing nature of the Krenim threat better than I can.
That shouldn't be a challenge,
Andos said lightly.
But to be clear, you have no idea what became of the other Kathryn Janeway?
No, Janeway replied. Based on the image of the child we believe to be hers left behind by Agent Dane, and our personal contact with the woman called Mala we encountered in the future version of Batabay,
the alternate timeline, Admiral,
Andos corrected her gently.
Director?
It will be incredibly important as we proceed to call things by their proper names,
Admiral Janeway. I realized you are not, nor should you be, as well-versed in temporal mechanics as I, but if we are to have any hope of minimizing the potential for future temporal violations, it will be necessary for you to reacquaint yourself with the proper terms.
An unpleasant and entirely predictable band of tension tightened itself across the Admiral's forehead. She had prided herself, for most of her career, on her ability to avoid the sorts of temporal shenanigans in which many other Starfleet officers seemed to constantly embroil themselves. She understood the dangers inherent in the manipulation of time, but more than that, she despised with the heat of a supernova reporting the incidents. Temporal mechanics, like all areas of scientific inquiry, was a constantly evolving field. Those immersed in it, like the director of the DTI and the field agents that served under her, added daily to their knowledge of the many ways in which space-time's dimensional boundaries could be altered. They lived on the cutting edge of temporal anomalies. Janeway had been happy to survive the coursework on the topic at the Academy. That in the last several years, she had so frequently found herself in a position where violating the temporal prime directive was the best of many bad options was more than annoying to Janeway. It felt like a deeply personal failure. Choosing her words with great care, the Admiral said,
"We cannot state to any degree of certainty that the alternate Kathryn Janeway, who was created when the Krenim targeted Voyager with a chroniton torpedo in 2377, is still alive and occupying our current timeline. We believe Agent Dane may have taken her with the intention of reuniting her with their daughter, Mala. The existence of the elderly Mala we encountered in the alternate timeline we visited, using the Zal's temporal portal, suggests the possibility that the child had been raised in that alternate timeline. The statues present in the grove there of the two brothers tie Dane directly to that timeline, and if his words to me can be believed, a dubious proposition at best, I know, the Krenim were responsible for its creation."
"But this Mala did not recognize you or the alternate Kathryn Janeway when she met you, did she?"
Andos asked.
"She did not appear to," Janeway admitted. "And any connection between her and the child in the portrait might be nothing more than wishful thinking. But if she spent any amount of time with her father prior to our arrival, she would no doubt have been informed of the necessity of not indicating that she knew us to avoid creating a temporal paradox."
"It was much too late by then to avoid any such thing," Andos cautioned her.
"Be that as it may, I like to believe she was Catherine's daughter, and somehow Dane managed to return her to her mother."
Andos shook her head slightly.
"I understand that desire, Admiral, but in the absence of concrete evidence, I am afraid we must consider the fate of the alternate Kathryn Janeway an issue as yet unresolved."
"I understand, Director."
"And one you will under no circumstances attempt to investigate further?"
"If it's something you feel strongly about."
"It is. The artifacts you mentioned that remain shielded, do they include the logs from Voyager's contact with the Krenim in the alternate timeline in which you encountered this anorax?"
Andos asked.
"Yes. The temporal buoys that housed them disintegrated after only a few hours once they were removed from subspace, but we had copied all of the logs by then."
"I am impressed with the resourcefulness of whichever version of you it was that decided to create those temporally shielded records. We utilize a similar protocol here, and my first order of business will be to have the agent I intend to assign to your case forward you the latest technological specifications for replicating the least invasive sustainable temporal shielding currently used by the DTI. I congratulate your mission specialist, Seven, on her industriousness, but I would prefer that Starfleet refrain from dabbling with Borg-inspired technology, especially when it comes to temporal disturbances."
Janeway's spine stiffened involuntarily. Seven was the only reason any trace of Voyager's previous encounter with the Krenim existed.
"Out here, in the wilds of unexplored space, I am not inclined to dismiss a good idea, no matter where it comes from, Director."
"That's because you cannot properly contextualize, as I can, the manner in which certain ideas have the potential to do much more harm than good. In every instance of which we are aware that the words Borg and temporal manipulation were used in proximity to one another, a cataclysmic end result was narrowly avoided. I must insist that you adhere to our regulations going forward, Admiral."
Therein lies our best hope of untangling any future temporal disturbances you may unintentionally cause. Thus far, the director hadn't hinted at disciplinary action as a result of the many violations of the temporal prime directive this latest incident might have indicated. But the warning was clear, and Janeway hastened to defend herself and her crew.
Director, we didn't go looking for this fight. We learned of the existence of the alternate Kathryn Janeway while attempting to open diplomatic relations with an unrelated species. This is the definition of my fleet's mission out here. Would the Department of Temporal Investigations have preferred that we not have investigated this anomaly? By doing so, haven't we revealed a potential threat to the Federation and made it more difficult for the Krenim, should they so desire, to act against us unawares?
A threat you caused, Admiral.
Check and mate. Janeway could not argue with the fact that it was Voyager's first encounter with the Krenim several years prior that had begun the series of tragic events that followed. Nor could she shift responsibility for the Krenim's current interest in her and other chaotic variables elsewhere. Her review of the shielded logs detailing that initial encounter had revealed in nauseating detail the depths to which her desire to end Anorax's reign of temporal terror had led her, the loss of much of her crew, and the destruction of Voyager. It had been a harsh realization, one for which she was now grateful.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.